so blind. My sin was before me, I was swallowed by pride. But out of the darkness you brought me to your light. You showed me new mercy and opened up my eyes. From the day you saved my soul, till the very moment when I come home, I'll sing, I'll dance, my heart will overflow. From the day you saved my soul, where brilliant light is all around, and endless joy is the only.
Make me broken so I can be healed. 'Cause I'm so calloused and now I can't feel. I wanna run to you with heart wide open. Make me broken. Make me empty so I can be filled. 'Cause I'm still holding onto my will, and I'm completed when you are with me. Make me empty till you are my one desire, till you are my one true love. Making me, make me lonely so I can be yours, till I want no one more than you, Lord. 'Cause in the darkness I know you will hold me. Make me lonely till you are my one desire, till you are my one true love, till you are my till you are my one desire, till you are my one true love, till you are my breath and my everything. Lord, please keep making, I know you'll keep making. Lord, please keep making me.
God who saves, bless the Lord. With your sins have been washed away, as the Lord. If you stand only by His grace,
bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. And let everything within me,
let everything within me,
let everything within me, bless the Lord. Sing an anthem to His beautiful name. Bless the Lord. Join the heavens, let the earth proclaim.
Bless the Lord.
His mercy is great and His love endures.
Bless the Lord.
Our faith is strong and our God is sure.
Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
And let everything within me,
let everything within me,
let everything within me,
bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
And let everything within me,
let everything within me,
let everything within me,
bless the Lord. At all times,
at all times,
I will bless the Lord. At all times,
at all times,
I will bless the Lord. At all times,
at all times,
I will bless the Lord. At all times,
at all times,
I will bless the Lord.
We'll be in 1 Samuel, we'll start in chapter 5 today. And in the last lesson from 2 weeks ago, we read about how the Israelites were being soundly defeated by the Philistines. And in chapter 4, we saw that having lost sight of the holiness of God, that the Israelites, remember, this is the period of the judges. This is the period when everyone's doing what's right in their own eyes, where it's much like today, isn't it? People had lost sight of the holiness of God. And because they had lost sight of the holiness of God, they had lost sight of the holiness of the things of God as well. And we read how they decided a good way to maybe turn the tide in battle was, let's go get the Ark of the Covenant. And you remember the Ark of the Covenant was kept in the Holy of Holies in the tabernacle, and it was only seen once a year by the high priest. Well, they begin to think the things of God were common. And so a good idea, they thought, was let's get the Ark of the Covenant, let's bring it to the battlefield, let's use it as sort of a good luck charm. Do you know any Christians that are in church, but they don't know the holiness of God, and they use their attendance in church as a good luck charm, missing the holiness of God? So they brought the Ark of the Covenant to the battlefield, and it was interesting. As we read, it was interesting. The Philistines, they remembered God. The Philistines remembered the God of the Israelites. They remembered how God had brought Israel across the Red Sea, how He brought plagues upon Egypt. And this had the opposite effect that they hoped for. The Philistines seen this ark come to the battlefield, and their commander said, "Boys, now is the time to fight for your life." you need to fight with everything you got, or you're going to be slaves to the Israelites. And so that's what they did, and they thumped Israel once again. And this time when Israel lost, they lost possession of the Ark of the Covenant. The Philistines took it. So having defeated the army of Israel and having captured the Ark of the Covenant, this did something to the Philistines. It convinced them that their idol, that their false god they called Dagon, he was a fish god. He had a human body, a fish head. Now, what's that sound like to you as we've been studying? It sounds like Nephilim, doesn't it? It sounds like the result of what the fallen angels were doing on the earth with people and with the animals. I'm telling you, they didn't just make up that image. It came from somewhere. But what the actions of Israel did, it encouraged the Philistines to fight hard. It encouraged the Philistines to beat him. It told the Philistines that their idol was stronger than the only true God of Israel. I tell you, you have a responsibility. You have a responsibility as a Christian that your action could do the same thing. That as a Christian and people know you're Christian and you come into difficult situations and your actions say, my God's not that powerful. People look to you. People are looking at you, and they could think, well, you know, so and so. I know they're churched, and they always are beating me up with wanting to talk about Jesus. But as soon as trouble came to them, they tucked their tails and ran. So I don't think that's all that in church. I don't think they believe in God like they have said. I don't know who they're trying to fool, but they're not fooling me. And I'm going to run as far away from God as I possibly can. You have a responsibility. So having defeated Israel, having captured the Ark of the Covenant, the Philistines were convinced again that their pagan god was mightier than the holy God of Israel. So they took the Ark of the Covenant, they took their newly won trophy, and they put it in their pagan temple next to the idol of their fish god, Dagon. Next morning, when it went out into the temple, the idol of Dagon was laying face down on the floor, and you look at that and you can see something. You can see that Jehovah God caused their idol to be in a worship position before his ark. But these Philistines, they thought, well, this has to be some kind of a fluke. You know, we don't know how that happened, but something happened. Maybe somebody leaving the temple tripped on the threshold and caused some kind of a vibration and this happened. So they set Dagon back up on his pedestal, and next morning, once again, their idol was face down on the floor, but this time both his hands and his head were broken off. Their idol was broken, and boy, you read that about, that should trigger your attention. Both his hands and his head were broken off, and it makes me think about what we know in coming in Revelation, where the mark will be in the hands or in the forehead. And we know that our allegiance to God, our obedience to God, we do it with our thoughts and with our actions, don't we? And so this time, God had caused their idol to fall on the floor, and both hands and his head were broken off. And I also come to read this, and I think we should look at it, and I think we should be a little introspective here and ask ourselves, what does God have to do? What does God have to do in my life to get me to recognize his holiness? Actually, recognize his holiness. You know, I think sometimes hard situations come to us, and we're all so quick to say, well, I think that Satan's coming against me. I think the enemy has his target on my back because I am walking so strong in faith, and maybe sometimes it's God that's trying to get your attention. Maybe it's not Satan at all. My Bible says that God chastises his children. Then I wonder what kind of tragedy it is if God's chastising us that we credit that to the work of Satan. And in that crediting Satan, maybe we're missing an opportunity to be corrected as God is trying to correct us from time to time. That we think everything that happens bad to us comes from only Satan. If people think that, then they're free to move forward, continuing in their errors, continuing to miss the holiness of God, missing the benefit of being corrected by a holy and loving God, forcing their way to a judgment that God doesn't want them to experience, that he gave his only son, Jesus, that we'd not have to experience that. But if we won't take correction, if we won't be corrected, if we won't from time to time alter our course as God would show us to alter, that's a problem. You know, maybe you should try something different. Maybe you should try humility for a change. Maybe you should recognize that you're not all that great. That you don't have this whole God thing perfectly figured out. That you don't live every moment of your life God in a God-honoring way. And sometimes God wants to correct us. I know it's true for me. You know, the Philistines once found themselves in a very similar place to that. They probably realized the superiority of the God of Israel to their idol the second time that he tumbled over. At that moment, they had a choice to make. They could reject their idol and begin serving the one true God of Israel, or they could make of the encounter some kind of a new religious tradition. The church is full of religious traditions that hide the holiness of God. What did the Philistines do? They chose to make a new religious tradition. And 1 Samuel 5:5 says, therefore neither the priest of Dagon nor any that come into Dagon's house tread on the threshold of Dagon in Ashdod to these days. Let's not trip over the threshold lest we cause the idol to fall over again, because surely something like that is what happened. Surely it didn't fall over because the God of Israel is mighty. So let's make some tradition, let's make some religious action out of it, and let's make sure when we go into the church that we don't step on the threshold, because it might displease God in some way. You know, I look at this and I think it's so interesting that the Philistine priests were like so many people today who come face to face with truth. People today who come face to face with truth and they still reject God despite all the evidence. These Philistines, despite the evidence, they were insisting that the destruction of their idol was an unfortunate accident. Who knows how long that idol sat in that temple? It never happened before. It never happened until the day they put the Ark of the Covenant with it. And then the same thing happens 2 days in a row. Second day worse than the first. But these people were unwilling to accept anything. They were willing to accept anything other than the truth of God. They would accept any lie, any ridiculous religious tradition they were willing to accept. Willing to accept that in the place of the truth of God, in the place of acknowledging the superiority of God, willing to accept anything other than the holiness of God. Why? Because if they begin worshiping the Lord instead of their idol, they'd be forced to change. People don't want to change. People don't want to accept that their thoughts are wrong and their actions are wrong and their deeds are wrong. That there is a holy God who reigns supreme, and his opinion of what I do is more important than my own opinion of what I do. That the things I do, I enjoy, even though they're destroying me, destroying my marriage, destroying my family, destroying my livelihood, destroying everything. You need to come to a point and you realize that what God wants for you is good. That becoming a follower of Jesus Christ is not about giving up, it's about gaining. It's about gaining a healthy life and letting go of all those things you've been doing that have been to your destruction. The Philistines didn't want to accept that Jehovah God was powerful because they would have to change, and they didn't want to change. What is it to worship an idol? People today have all sorts of idols. A job, a home, a person. It's nothing. Which idol was ever worshipped that demanded that person change to the better? It's never happened. You know, for the Philistines, setting their idol back up the second time and gluing his hands back on, gluing his head back on, was easier than changing their beliefs, easier than changing the way they conducted themselves, easier than changing the thinking. And since they were too stubborn to repent and worship God, he sent a curse upon them, a curse of boils. Does it say that Satan sent that? It does not say that Satan sent that. It says God sent a curse of boils. He gave the Philistines boils who were near the Ark of the Covenant. And you should look at that. And you should look at that and you should see if you want to be stubborn. Listen, if you want to be stubborn and you want to ignore what God's telling you, the things he's doing to get your attention, the second time he tries to get your attention are going to be less pleasant than the first time. And it may get to the point where Satan does touch you, where God allows Satan to touch you just as he allowed Satan to touch Job. And you need to know that if God allows, God's in control. Satan is not a free agent. That everything he does, he has the permission of God to do. And if God allows Satan to touch you, it's for your good and God's glory. And it's probably because you've not been listening. It's probably because you've been too stubborn to see the things that God has been doing in your life to try to get you to change your way. As the Philistines began to realize that their troubles really began, that these boils began when they took possession of the Ark of the Covenant, they took it in. They took the Ark of the Covenant in, and their idol kept getting toppled over, and then they got boils. They thought, here's a great idea. Let's gift our neighbors with this Ark of the Covenant. We'll be seen as the good guys. So it says they carried the Ark of the Covenant to another city of the Philistines called Gath. And you should know the city of Gath. We all know of a man who we will come to in our study called Goliath of Gath. This is the city of Goliath. And it says that no sooner did the people of Gath take possession of the ark, they also begin to break out with boils all over them. And that there's even worse. It says in their secret parts. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't want boils in my secret parts. And so those folks, they quickly decide, I know what a good idea would be. Let's send it to the next town. It's like playing a hot potato. So they decided to send it to the town of Ekron. And the men of Ekron said, and I'll summarize in 1 Samuel chapter 5, oh no, you're not bringing it here, we don't want it. That's a summary of what they said. So this thing was getting to be well known that whatever you do, you don't want the Ark of the Covenant of the Israelites. So they were seeing that wherever they took the Ark, the hand of God was heavy, and people were suffering boils, there were people dying. But they didn't know what to do with it. So in chapter 6, after having the ark for 7 disastrous months, the Philistines called on their religious leaders and they asked, what should we do with this thing? This thing's a disaster. And their leaders said, well, send it back to Israel. We don't want it. Send it back to them. It's theirs. But send it back with a trespass offering. Let's try to please their God. Let's You know, let's not just trust that sending this good luck charm back is sufficient to please our God. Let's send a trespass offering along with it. So make this is wild to me. Make golden images of your boils. And little golden mice also. So I can't find it in my Bible. Mice, I would infer that mice must have been eating their crops. And put the golden images of your boils and images of mice in the Ark of the Covenant. It says, and then hitch it to two milk cows. So a milk cow is a cow who has had a calf. So these cows had calves with them. And put the Ark of the Covenant on a cart and take the calves away from those two cows and let those two cows loose. Now, most of us are close enough to rural living that maybe you heard calves weaned from cows. Where I grew up, you'd hear that every fall. You'd hear the neighbors' cows and calves separated, and there's a bawling all night for, you know, maybe 2 days, cows bawling for calves and calves doing the same thing. So the Philistine leader said, take the calves away from those cows, and with the cows hitched to the cart and the Ark of the Covenant on a cow cart, and turn the cows loose. And if the cows head directly back to the camp of Israel, then you know that this was all caused by the God of Israel. But the cows won't lead their calves, then you know everything that's happened has just been bad luck. It's just been happenstance. And, you know, probability on just a natural field, probability is those cows are not going to leave their calves. It takes a supernatural hand of God to get those cows to walk away. So the Philistines did as the priest suggested, and they let the cows loose, and it says that the cows made a direct line for the camp of Israel, bawling for their calves the whole way. That in their bawling for their calves, you can see that this was not a natural event, that it was supernatural. And who do you suppose, as you read that, who do you suppose was driving those cows in the direction they went? Well, I think it was the Holy Spirit of God that was superseding this. Five of the lords of the Philistines followed to see what would happen, and they followed the cows all the way, and they saw that they went directly back to the camp of Israel. And 1 Samuel 6:12 it says, "And the kine, which are these cows, these milk cows, took the straight way to the way of Beth Shemesh, and went along the highway, lowing as they went, and turned not aside to the right hand or left. And the lords of Philistines went after them to the border of Beth Shemesh, and they of Beth Shemesh were reaping their wheat harvest in the valley, and they lifted up their eyes and saw the ark and rejoiced to see it." Now you read that, and because I know you're such good studied Bible students, you should see some foreshadowing here. That, you know, we read about the orphan son of, or the orphan grandson of Eli, who was orphaned at birth. Remember that when the ark was taken, and we saw that he was named Ichabod. And Ichabod being the glory of the Lord has departed. Here with God moving against the Philistines for 7 months, moving against them until they were desperate to rid themselves of the Ark of the Covenant, and with God's Holy Spirit directing these two cows to pull the ark back to Israel, you see God's glory returning to Israel. It was returning in the form of the Ark of the Covenant. I want you to always look at the detail. Always look at the detail of what you're reading. I tell you all the time, there's an interesting detail that I just read to you. A specific time that this was happening. It was the wheat harvest. We just went through a small study on the wheat harvest. And as a church, we know we await a wheat harvest rapture when God comes to claim us. And what will happen when we're raptured? This is the foreshadowing that the glory of God and Jesus Christ will be rejoined with the church. And so this, the Ark of the Covenant going back to Israel in the wheat harvest is a foreshadowing of the rapture that we await. So once the Philistine leaders saw the Ark of the Covenant return to the camp of Israel, they were confident that it had been the hand of the Lord of Israel that had been moving against them for the past 7 months. Now the Israelites, we remember who they were. There were people who were doing what was right in their own eyes. There were people who had forgotten the holiness of God, who had thought the Ark of the Covenant to be a common thing, they disassembled the cart and they set it on fire and slaughtered the cows and put them on the fire for a burnt offering. None of it in accordance with the law of God. They'd forgotten the law of God. 1 Samuel 6:19 says, and he being God, smote the men of Beth Shemesh because they had looked into the ark of the Lord. They forgot the holiness of God. Remember, this is the same ark that was supposed to only be looked upon by the high priest once a year. Hey, this thing's come back in the camp. Let's look, lift the lid and see what's inside of it. It says, and this is a hard verse to understand. It says, he smote the people, 50,000, 70 men. And the people, so what's saying, he smote of the people 50,000. You should have a comma there. There were 50,000 of them. But he killed 70 or 70 men. And the people lamented because the Lord had smitten many of the people with a great slaughter. Again, remember, this happened because people were doing what was right in their own eyes. They weren't doing the things that God had told them to do. This happened because, again, people were thinking of the things of the Lord to be common. Look at the people you know. How many people think the things of the Lord are common? How many think the church is to be taken lightly? I have no need of church. I have no need of the Bible. I have no need of anything with God because I'm living my life in a way that's right in my own eyes. That I will decide for myself what's right and wrong. People don't change much. So Israel, at the start of this, Israel had begun to treat the things of God as common, and that behavior just continues. And you read about these 70 people being killed because they lifted the lid of the Ark of the Covenant, and you should think about, you know, where this journey of God in Israel began at the Exodus. You remember they gathered, came out of Egypt, they gathered there at the base of Mount Sinai. God's presence settled on the top of the mountain. The mountain was filled with lightning and thunder. In the presence of God, God's holiness was there. And anyone who touched even the base of the mountain would die. These people forgot, and they looked inside. And at verse 6:20, it says, the men of Beth Shemesh said, who's able to stand before this holy God? And who shall go up from us? And they sent messengers. Remember the people in Moses' day at Mount Sinai saying that same thing? We don't want to hear from him. Who could survive this God? Moses, you go listen. Here's the same attitude. And they sent messengers to the inhabitants of Kirjath-Jearim saying, the Philistines have brought again the Ark of the Lord. Come to you down and fetch it up to you. In other words, these Israelites took the same attitude toward the Ark of God that the Philistines had. They said, we don't want it. Neighbor, you come get it. We got to get rid of this thing. 70 people just died because of this thing. We don't have a clue why, because we've forgotten who God is. And they ask, who can stand before God? Who can stand before the holiness of God? And that's a very interesting question. It's a very pertinent question. Now, even as Christians, we need to strive to understand, to recognize, to see the holiness of God. I don't think we get it. I don't think we get the holiness of God. We read that he lives in a light that is so powerful and so pure that no one can approach and live. I don't know if we get that. Now, how can we, any of us, try to stand before a holy God in our own righteousness when we have none? The answer is we can't. We can't. And that's why we need Jesus Christ. Who's able to stand before God? Only those who have Jesus. Only those whose sins have been forgiven by Jesus. Only those who have been washed clean by the blood of Jesus. You know, these men of Beth Shemesh when 70 of them had died, and they started to grasp a little bit of the holiness of God, they didn't want to get closer to God. They wanted to put distance between themselves and God. Again, they were just like the Philistines. What's that mean? That they were just like the Philistines? In what way? They were just like the Philistines in that the holiness of God was a problem for them. A problem that could only be fixed if they set space between them and God. If they set space between them and the ark of God. And that is exactly the same place that people are today. That's exactly the same thing people are wrestling with today. And they come up today with the same fatal answer time and time and time again. How do I deal with a holy God? I deal with a holy God by ignoring that he exists and by putting distance between him and I, and everything will be okay. Everything won't be okay. The only thing everything will be okay is if you have Jesus Christ. It's the only way. You know, ultimately, that response isn't a response to the holiness of God. That response is a response to our sinfulness in front of a holy God. That people recognize, they don't mentally acknowledge it, but they recognize their sinfulness. They recognize that things they do are an offense to a holy God. And so when Adam and Eve first sinned and they came to this recognition, what did they do? They tried to hide themselves. They tried to put distance between themselves and God. And that's where people are still living today. Trying to ignore God, trying to hide from God, trying to put distance between themselves and God. This was the question in that day. How can we stand before a holy God? There's no way for us to be right. So since we can't find a way, how can we give this ark to someone else? How can we put that distance? Can you get enough distance from God? He's omnipresent. He's omnipotent. He's everywhere. He knows everything. How can anyone do that? You go back to the Garden of Eden, you look at that conversation, and God said, "Where are you?" You think God didn't know where they were? He was giving them a chance to repent. Who told you this? You think God didn't know who told them? Absolutely, he knew. He's given them the opportunity to repent, and he gives each and every one of us an opportunity to repent. Are you a repentant person? I wish I didn't have so much to repent for. But I find myself repenting all the time. I'm so sorry I did that. I'm so sorry I thought that. I'm so sorry I said that. Give me your Holy Spirit. Help me to be better. Help me be more and more every day like Jesus Christ. You know, if I can ever get to the end of one day and think that I got there and didn't need to repent of anything, I click my heels and think I made it to Kansas. I'm not that good. You're not that good either. That's what I said earlier. How about being humble? How about being honest with yourself, realizing I'm not that good and I need a kinsman redeemer. I need Jesus Christ because there's no other way. That everything else I've done, I've made a mess of. I look back on all the things I've done without Jesus and it's all a mess. Every bit of it's a mess. Every bit of it's broken. How I wish I'd had Jesus earlier. How I wish I'd unknown earlier, how I wish I'd lived my life to this point differently. Because those idols of worship couldn't make me change. And now I know truth, now I know one who can make me change, and he'll forgive me of all my failures, he'll forgive me of all those things I've done. That with the blood of Jesus, I don't have to stand one day in front of a holy and righteous God in shame that I could stand there. I could say, I'm in him. That Jesus died for me. That his blood washes me clean. Chapter 7, verse 1 says, and the man Kirith Jearim came and fetched up the ark of the Lord and brought it to the house of Abinadab in the hill, and sanctify Eleazar, his son, to keep the ark of the Lord. Boy, I read that and I think, what a privilege this fellow had that he was sanctified to keep the ark of the Lord. I think in that day, he probably drew the short straw. He said, who's going to keep this thing? It's been a disaster to Philistines. It's been a disaster to us. Let's put it in And Eleazar is house, and let him keep it. Then if something goes wrong, it's only one guy dying, right? Instead of 70 of us. So as you continue to study, you find out the Ark of the Covenant sat in the home of this fellow for 20 years. And it says all of Israel grieved. And now Samuel rejoins us in the first couple of chapters. We saw Samuel as a young man. I just told you the Ark of the Covenant sat in this fellow's house for 20 years. You know, time's passing. Now in verse 3, we see Samuel as an adult, and it says, "And Samuel spoke to all the house of Israel, saying, if you do return unto the Lord with all your hearts and put away the strange gods." Boy, this holds true today. This is a call of Samuel even to this day. If you return to the Lord with all your hearts, put away the strange gods and Astaroth from among you, and prepare your hearts unto the Lord. Astaroth, if you remember, she was a goddess of sexual lust. Let's say it that way. And prepare your hearts to the Lord and serve him only. He will deliver you out of the hands of the Philistines. Samuel's saying, if you'll come back to God, God will come back to you. If you'll act for God, God will act for you. If you'll be loyal to him, he'll be loyal to you. It's the stuff of relationship. We talk here all the time about relationship. The Old Testament talks about relationship. You know, the Israelites in this day, they were still worshiping, they were still joining in the worship of false gods in the land of Canaan. So Samuel comes on the scene, the last judge of Israel, and he says, put away the false gods, begin to serve only the true God, Jehovah, the one that brought our people out of Egypt, serve him only. And they listen for a time. And they start to put away their idols and put them aside. In verse 5, and Samuel said, gather all Israel to Mizpah, and I'll pray for you unto the Lord. And they gathered together at Mizpah, and they drew water and poured it out before the Lord and fasted on that day and said there, we've sinned against the Lord. Repentance. God wants us to be people of repentance. He can forgive, but we got to know we need forgiven. And Samuel judged the children of Israel at Mizpah. And you continue reading, it says, and the Philistines heard of this. They heard how the Israelites were gathered together in this place. They were fasting and they were ritually pouring out water. And, you know, how do we get physically when we've been fasting? We get less and less energy, don't we? We get weaker physically, stronger spiritually, weaker physically. So they were looking on the physical and they thought this would be a great time to attack Israel. Let's get them when they're all in one place. Let's get them when they're fasting and they're weakened and their focus is attention on doing the religious things they're doing. And at verse 7 it says, and when the children of Israel heard it, they were afraid of the Philistines. When they heard that the Philistines were gathering, and the children of Israel said to Samuel, cease not to cry out unto the Lord our God for us, that he will save us out of the hand of the Philistines. And Samuel took a sucking lamb and offered it for a burnt offering holy unto the Lord. And Samuel cried unto the Lord of Israel, and the Lord heard him. The Lord heard him, that the Lord hears the voice of those who are his, the voices of those who are loyal to him. It says, and as the Philistines drew near to battle against Israel, that the Lord thundered with a great thunder, which unnerved the Philistines. So God's fighting with Israel in supernatural ways. He's bringing a great thunder, and it's probably not like the thunder we heard this morning. It's a great thunder. And unnerved the Philistines. And so God from heaven is fighting on behalf of the Philistines. And he sent the Philistines running, sent them into defeat. And it's amazing. If you look at this one action of God, in one action, this thunder, God sent confusion into the Philistines and he sent confidence into Israel. So God's ways of working are complex. At verse 12 it says, and then Samuel took a stone and set between Mizpah and Shin and called it Ebenezer, saying, here too hath the Lord helped us. So he set up a stone as a place of reminder. And the word Ebenezer in the Hebrew means a stone of help. So he set up the stone that all of Israel will always remember this place where God interacted with them. And do you ever do that in your own lives? Do you have these memories of this time and I was in this place? And in a very specific way, I felt the hand of God moving in my life to, in such a way maybe nothing will ever be the same for me again. The Israelites would set up stones. And I don't know about you, I have some places like that I've not set up a physical stone, but there are a few places that I can tell you exactly what God put on my heart, exactly where I was at, because those are milestone events. So up to this point, again, the Philistines had been beating them in every battle, but suddenly Israel subdued the Philistines, and it says in this chapter, the Philistines came no more into the coast of Israel. During all the days of Samuel, and the cities that the Philistines had taken from Israel were returned to Israel. And it says that Samuel judged Israel all the days of his life. And he went from year to year in circuit. You know, if you look at, say, the Old West in the United States, we had circuit judges. You know, they traveled from town to town judging legal cases. Samuel was a circuit prophet that he'd go in a circuit. He'd go from town to minister to the people. And then eventually he'd return to his home in Ramah. So I think there's a lot in that lesson today. God does a lot of things to correct us and to get our attention. And I know in my case, it was pretty severe. You know, I'm not the only one in here. We're a weird church where we've got several people in here who have lost children. I wish there weren't so many of us, but there are many of us. I know in my situation, that's what God had to do to get my attention. I know I've said before, if my son didn't go too early, this church wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be in the place I am with God. We wouldn't have this baptism last week. So don't be so stubborn as I've been. Listen to what the Lord's doing. When he corrects you, take correction. Everything God does is good. God does everything very good to those who love him. And so sometimes things don't feel good, but I praise God today that my son had every opportunity to take him as Savior and be saved. And I pray I see him in heaven someday. So let's recognize the holiness of God, and let's recognize that he corrects us, that we need not look at our own sin and try to put distance between us and God. We need to look at our own sin and say, I need a Savior. I need a solution. And we need to run to Jesus Christ. We need to embrace him. Let's pray as we finish today. Dear Heavenly Father, boy, we do look forward to that day when we all get to heaven, because we know we're people who are sin-fallen, and we need not put distance between you and us. We can't hide from you. That we need to embrace Jesus, and we'll have glory in him. We'll have glory with him. And so, Father, help us. Give us your Holy Spirit. Help us to humble ourselves. Help us not to reject you because of your holiness, but to cling to Jesus because of our sin, that he is the mediator, that he stands between you and us, that the problems can be forgiven, and that we can know glory. So, Father, we look forward to the day when we all stand in heaven. There will be no party in hell, we know that, but there's going to be a grand party in heaven. Until then, Father, in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.